Well, we continue in Genesis where we left off last Sunday. So we find ourselves today in Genesis chapter 2. We'll be focusing on verses 10 to 17. Genesis 2, 10 to 17. Do you ever watch movies or read books that speak about different kind of imaginary worlds? So whether it's like sci-fi, that, you know, some kind of fictional world, maybe in space or in the future or so forth, or like Star Wars, Narnia is a fictional world in a different way, written by C.S. Lewis, of course, and has a lot of Christian themes, Narnia, or Lord of the Rings, that has this different kind of world with the hobbits and everything. Why are these kind of books and stories, why are they so popular? Why are they fascinating? Obviously, they've, you know, been written by very talented writers or done by very talented movie makers or such. But I think one of the key issues in all of this is that it presents to us an imaginary world of amazement and wonder, you know, and you kind of look and you're like, especially nowadays with all the movie effect, you can like, whoa, you know, and it looks like it's real. You could see a movie with like dinosaurs and all these things, and it looked, if you wouldn't know any better, it's like real, except it's been made by computer generated images. And there's this aspect of wonder and excitement and like exploring these fictional worlds, which we know are fictional, but there's still this excitement. But the truth is that reality is even better than fiction. The truth is that reality is even better. And I think even fiction, when rightly used, should encourage and excite Christians about the true reality of the future and the new heavens and the new earth, part of which was from Isaiah, the passage in Isaiah which we read earlier, and then many other passages in the Bible. So that excitement to look forward to this time when God will restore everything and the earth will be more amazing than we can even imagine. More amazing than any of those fictional stories. It'll be like God meant it to be. But at the same time, the earth was similar to that in the past. So we look to the future when God will restore all things and everything will be amazing. But in the past, in the history of the earth that we live on, the earth has an amazing past, and there was a time when this earth looked in many ways even different. There was a time that this earth looked different and it was glorious. So if you see some of these fictional movies that might have these amazing whatever waterfalls and beautiful trees and all these kind of things, and you're like, whoa. Well, the reality is that this used to be, you know, the earth in the beginning was something like that and even greater, and in the future it will be like that and even greater. So today, in this passage that we will be looking at, we will see aspects and reminders of the world that was lost, the world that perished, the world that was lost and the world that perished. It obviously perished in the worldwide flood, which we then will not be focusing on today, but we'll see later as we go in Genesis. But this passage describes to us aspects of the earth before sin, before the flood, and before this earth perished, and we now live in a different kind of world. The same globe, the same world, but destroyed and marred and cursed. So let me read to you first, in Genesis chapter 2, beginning at verse 4. And to the end of the chapter. Genesis chapter 2, verse 4. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground. And a mist was going up from the land and was watering the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground the Lord God made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A river flowed out of Eden to water the garden, and there it divided and became four rivers. The name of the first is the Pishon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold. And the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is the Gihon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Cush. And the name of the third river is the Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens, and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man. And while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." And so I'll end the reading there. So, as I said, we'll focus on verses 10 to 17 today. We are given here, in beginning of verse 10 till verse 14, a description of different rivers. There's even multiple names of rivers. There's even names of places. There's names of gemstones, and gold is mentioned. And all of this begins, as we already last week kind of talked a little bit, it talks about Eden and the garden that was in Eden. And a lot of speculation has been done, a lot of books have been done, a lot of views, different views of and questions about Eden. Where is Eden? Can we know where Eden was? Can we know what these rivers are? And there are different people saying different things. Maybe Eden was there, maybe Eden was there, and they have different reasonings. But biblically speaking, can we know where Eden was? Can we know? Can we even know what these rivers were? Can we? Simply said, no. No, we cannot. We cannot. And the reason for that is that this is before the flood. This is before the flood. If I told you that there's a little village, you know, say there's maybe 20 wooden houses, and I told you about the history of this village, and then I also told you the different names of those houses. They had, you know, based on their families. Let's just say for simplicity, there's 10 houses, they have different names, and I told you the names of those houses. And then later in the story, I tell you that at one point, a few years later, there was a great fire that destroyed everything. And obviously destroyed the houses and everything burnt down. And then later on, you know, there's a long, complicated story and there's a lot of things that happen. Then I mention that there's a house named the same as some of those houses, the original houses were named. Will you then, as the listener of the story, think that it's the same exact house because it has the same name? You know, say that this was the Smith's house and everything was destroyed. And I told you everything was destroyed. And later there's another, there's a house again and it's referred to by the same name. Is that proof that that house wasn't destroyed? No, it's simply proof that the people used similar names again after the catastrophe to name houses or places and such. And that's the same that we see here in this passage today. And when you might be thinking, what is he really talking about? Well, some of these rivers like Tigris and Euphrates, there is still, and there's later in biblical history, there are two great rivers in Mesopotamia that are named Tigris and Euphrates. And the Bible refers to these kind of two rivers later on in the story also. So then some people think this must be at this point when it's talking that it's the same rivers because it's the same name, right? No, it's not, because there was a great catastrophe in the middle. And it's very important for us to understand that. And that way, we also understand that it is, in that sense, futile to try and find exactly these locations in our modern post-flood world, because the flood destroyed everything. The flood completely, radically rearranged the surface of the earth, the plate tectonics, when the country, the land masses broke apart and such. There's been a huge catastrophe like never been before in the flood. And the whole earth was covered in water. The highest mountain was covered with water. And if you have the highest mountains covered with water, that means that the earth is, the flood is global and everything was covered. And it was a catastrophe like never before. And everything was destroyed. Let me just read to you a few verses regarding this. In Genesis chapter 6, which we'll get to when we finally get there and we'll talk more about it. But I want to point out briefly a few things relating to, as we think about these rivers that are mentioned in Genesis 2. So Genesis 6, verse 17. Here, God is speaking to Noah and he says, "For behold, I will bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh in which is the breath of life under heaven. Everything that is on the earth shall die. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall come into the ark, you and your sons, your wife, your son's wife." And then Noah also brought representatives of all the created animal kinds, of course. And then earlier there, in verse 13, it says that the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. God was destroying all the ungodliness that was rampant, everything except those people and those animals that were on the ark. Everything else was destroyed. apart from obviously some sea creatures that were fine in the water, but every land-dwelling animal was destroyed, and that's why we have fossils all over the earth. And we'll get to that when we come more and talk about the flood. But so there was this great catastrophe after the description that we read in Genesis 2. And this kind of worldwide cataclysmic destruction of the earth will completely alter everything, including the location of rivers, or including the location of Eden. In fact, Dr. Jonathan Sarfati, who is a Christian and a scientist, he has two different scientific degrees. I don't remember what he's focused on. Well, he's written a good commentary on Genesis, but it's kind of a hypothesis, but his guess is that Eden, the location of Eden, is probably buried a few kilometers in sediment. And which would have happened during the global flood. So, this description describes to us a lost world, a perished world, a world that no longer exists in this form. But it did exist then. And in the future, when God will restore things, we know that there will be a river flowing from the New Jerusalem, and it will be very similar and even greater. And just one more verse in Genesis regarding the flood. In Genesis chapter 7, verse 19, it says, "And the waters prevailed so mightily on the earth that all the high mountains under the whole heaven were covered." As I said, if you got the highest mountains covered with water, water goes down. You know, it's a simple scientific experiment. Everything is covered in water. Why do I emphasize that? Because there's Christians even who believe that the flood was only local. Like it was only like in a little valley, like where Noah lived, and the rest of the world was fine. And the reason they believe that is because they're committed to a kind of evolutionary dating of things, and they believe in millions and millions and billions of years. But the biblical flood was worldwide, and that's why we have fossils all over the world, even on high mountaintops. And in 2 Peter in the New Testament, there's also interesting comment regarding the flood and the world that perished. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 6, 2 Peter, let me read to you actually from verse 4. It talks here about scoffers, people who scoff because of their sinful desires. They will scoff the promises of God. And so 2 Peter 3, verse 4, it says, "They will say, where is the promise of his coming?" Well, you know, you say Jesus is coming. You say he's supposed to come. Where is the promise of his coming? And then they say, "Forever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation." They say nothing's changed. Everything's just the same. And then Peter says, verse 5, "For they deliberately overlook this fact that the heavens existed long ago and the earth was formed out of water and through water, by the word of God." And then verse 6, "And that by means of these, the world that then existed," notice, "the world that then existed was deluged with water and perished." It was covered with water and it perished. The world that then existed was lost and destroyed because of the global flood. And it was a sign of God's judgment. And it also then, and Peter then goes on to remind them of God's patience and God's future judgment. And then he later says in verse 13, he says, "According to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells." So that's the future. And then he said, the world that then existed perished. So, but back to Genesis then. Back to Genesis chapter 2 and about these rivers. What can we learn about these rivers? Why are we even told about these rivers? Which is an interesting thought. Why are we given all these details? And what do these details tell us? If these places don't even exist anymore, why is it important for us to know about them? There's a few reasons, I believe, why God has given us a description of these rivers and these places in the Bible. And the first simple one is that it's a historical account. It's a historical account, and as a historical account, it describes places and people and names and different natural resources that then existed. This is not just some kind of spiritual myth language. These are actual places, actual things, actual rivers, actual locations, actual gemstones, and actual gold, and so forth. So it's a historical account. And as a side note also, I believe Adam wrote down this you know, as it begins in verse 4 in chapter 2, it says these are the generations, the toledots. We don't know for sure, but it seems like these 11 toledots that we have all throughout the book of Genesis, that they were like these original records, and then Moses used these original records that were the people of Israel had, and by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Moses was the final editor. And he put together, as the Holy Spirit guided him, and he used that which was faithfully being transmitted among the people of Israel. And so Adam, he was there. He's seen these places, and even Adam's descendants, they would have known these places, and Adam would have written down and told his children about these different things. So anyway, Adam is likely kind of the original narrator, and then Moses as the editor of all of it under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, of course. But so Adam describes this world, and he describes how it was a world before the flood, before all things were altered. And I also believe that what it shows us, these descriptions of these rivers, it shows God's provision. God's provision. It's maybe something we don't think about, especially in Finland. We don't appreciate often the importance of water. The importance of water. The importance of rivers. The importance of having a river that you are near for your crops to grow, for the land to be healthy, for you to drink. Water. God provides water. And in the beginning, the water all came. There was a river, like verse 10 says, a river flowed out of Eden. And it seems like there was this, like basically a big spring, like it's like bubbled up, like it says there earlier also verse 6 in chapter 2, and a mist was going up from the land, and there was watering the whole face of the ground. And then here we're described that this river flowed out of Eden. And Eden was probably on a little mountain or a hill, because if it flowed from there, water goes down, obviously. And it watered the garden. At this point, there wasn't rain yet. It watered the garden through the ground somehow, and there was the mist. We don't know exactly. This world was lost. This world was destroyed. We've never seen it. But this is what happened. And then this one river that came and watered the garden was divided and became four rivers, or literally four heads of rivers. So God provides for his creatures. God provides for Adam and then Eve and their descendants. And he provides to us still today. And you should praise God that you're able to drink a cup of water. Water. That you have water to drink. You have water from your taps, or, you know, and you have water. Praise God. Give thanks that he sustains your life. So God sustains and God provides. And not only was there water, why are these mentioned? There's, you know, there's the mention of gold, there's the mention of bdellium and onyx, which we're not completely sure exactly what they're referring to, but it was referring to some kind of gemstone, some kind of, you know, like diamonds and gold and all kind of these natural resources that God has made. He provided them. He has provided this beautiful earth. He provided the plants, the animals, and everything else. So it shows us God's provision. And I also believe that one thing that this shows us is the importance of places and even names of places. And you might be like, what do you mean? What do you mean? Well, I think even sometimes as Christians, we're tempted to think that the only things that matter are spiritual things. And we like live in this kind of like a spiritual reality. And then, yes, there's the world, there's my daily thing and whatever. But that just have, oh, the spiritual things are so much, you know, just everything about that. But God in the beginning, yes, He created us as spiritual beings. But even before sin, even before the fall, even before the flood, there was locations, you know, locations. Mankind was never created to just live in some kind of spiritual existence, you know? Or like be connected to some kind of matrix, you know, like there's the movie which I watched probably, I don't know, 15 years ago. I don't even remember the story, but I remember from that movie that the guy is like plugged into basically a computer and just like lives in this virtual reality, in this matrix. That's not how God created the world. We are not plugged into just some kind of spiritual existence. We are created with bodies, with an immaterial aspect of life and being created in the image of God and souls, as we call it often. But we're created with bodies. There's places, there's locations, there's things to see, things to do. There's rivers there, there's not a river there, there's land there, there's things to explore, things to use, things to exercise dominion over. Even before sin, even before the curse, mankind was never created to just sit in one location and just like, you know, think about his own navel, so to say. Just like, you know, some, like most religions of the world are just this, you know, self-centered, self-righteous things about just like some spiritual reality or something. No, that's not how God created us. He created us to give honor and glory to Him. He created us as spiritual beings and to worship Him. But He also created us to do, to exercise dominion, to learn, to use, and to enjoy all these things that He has made. And that brings me to the last point in regard to answering the question, why all these details? I also believe that these details are here to remind us to show that even though man was placed in the garden, and that was his assignment, as we'll see just in a minute, the point was never to just be there in the long term. The point was that mankind would expand. Adam and Eve will have children, and their children would, and then they would go on even from the garden and like expand the garden, take over this domain that God has created and order it and to use it and to enjoy it and all for the glory of God. That they were to exercise dominion not simply in the long term, only the garden, but simply then to later even expand the garden and the rivers and the lands and everything else that existed. We know, of course, that Adam and Eve rebelled, and that's why the kind of everything went wrong. Okay, well, so let me read again these verses here and a few more comments about these rivers. Verse 10, a river flowed out of Eden to water the garden. There it divided and became four rivers or four heads of rivers. So we've seen at that already. Then verse 11 mentions the first river. It says, the name of the first is the Pishon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Havilah where there is gold. So the first river is here mentioned. This river, this name of this river is never again mentioned in all of Scripture. Never again mentioned. And yeah, it's part of that lost world. But we know there was a river. The first one was this one. And it flowed around the whole land of Havilah. We know that there was a land called Havilah. There was a place called Havilah. Again, we don't know where exactly it was and such, because that world perished. And we know that in Havilah, apparently, there was a lot of gold. So God created gemstones and gold in the beginning also. And then some of those gold and gemstones, obviously, because of the flood, they've been... That's why you find little pieces of gold in like big pieces of rock, because everything's been mixed up and rumbled all over the place. And yeah, but in the beginning, God had created even just like, I guess, piles of gold in different places where they could then go and you take that and use those natural resources. Then verse 12 describes, it says, and the gold of that land is good. There was very good gold there. There was plenty, and that's why it's mentioned here. God provided rich natural resources. And even these things were part of what mankind would then use, and they should use it in a way that honors God. And you might still today, you might have, you know, well, I have some gold on my wedding ring, you know, and people still appreciate gold because, well, I guess it looks nice and it's very good material and such. God created these things for us to use them, to fashion them, to make them into things that are helpful and things that honor God. People then obviously use them wrongly, like the golden calf was obviously like the most clear example of wrongly using things that God has made. But even from the beginning, we were called to use these things. Then it's mentioned, it says, there was the gold and it was good. Then there was beryllium and onyx stone. That's the ESV. There, depending on different translations, might even have different words for these. Part of the problem is that we don't know exactly what these are referring to. Beryllium, some people say they might even refer to some pearl-like things, some kind of stones. I don't know. Onyx stone is a black, dark black gemstone. But even some people say that this word, we're not even sure if it's an onyx stone or not. It could be also lapis lazuli, which is a dark blue gemstone. Some of you might even have in your jewelry or at home. My mom and dad used to sell jewelry, and my mom still does, and gemstones. So I've seen a lot of lapis lazuli and different kind of gemstones. What's the point here? The point is God created an abundance of all kinds of different natural resources. And whether they were specifically one of the other, God created them all. And in this specific place in Havilah, there was a lot of it. And as I said, I believe Adam is the one recording these things. And Adam is just commenting on that and probably making these comments and teaching even his children that, oh yeah, in Havilah, there's a lot of it. There's a lot of gold. But this all was destroyed because of the flood. Then the second river in verse 13, it says the name of the second river is the Gihon. Gihon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Cush. So we're giving a name of a river, and then it says it flowed around the whole land of Cush. And so Cush is later in the Bible used as a word. It basically describes what we think of as Ethiopia today. The land of Cush is the land of Ethiopia. So does that mean that the river, some people believe that one of the rivers there is the river Gihon, specifically that one in Ethiopia. There's a lot of problems with that just location-wise and so forth, because these were all connected, these four rivers. But again, it's important to us to realize that this happened before the destruction. And even though they have the same, some of them have same names, that doesn't mean that it's the same river. Let me give you a modern example of how when things have similar names or the same names. Even just this week, I spoke to a Christian brother in America. Well, I should not have said that he was in America because this kind of destroys my point here. Anyway, forget that he's in America. He lives in Birmingham. He lives in Birmingham. If I just told you he lives, I have a friend who lives in Birmingham, Some of you would think, oh, so he's in England, right? England. No, he lives in Birmingham, Alabama, in America. So there's a Birmingham in Alabama, there's a Birmingham in America. If I talk to you about Manchester, what will you think about? You will think of probably England. You know, there's a place called Manchester in America. If I talk to you about Oxford, you will think about England. There's a place called Oxford in America. There's even a place called Moscow in Idaho in America. What's my point? Even still in our modern day, even in Finland, when we drive to our cabin, there's a place named Canaan. Canaan, like in biblical Canaan. People use names for places and ideas that they know from previous things. And they use those kind of names again. So think about the people before the flood. They knew, the descendants of Adam and Eve knew that there was the land of Cush. They knew the Gihon, they knew Tigris. And all that. So then after the flood, Noah's descendants, when they come and then they see a river, oh, I remember that river. And it maybe was roughly in the same place, but it wasn't. And it's like, oh, yeah, remember the great Euphrates, Let's call this Euphrates. Let's call this one Euphrates also, just like the old one. That's what the American settlers, the Pilgrim Fathers, when they went from England to America, that's why they called so many of the places English names, because it maybe reminded them of something from England. And no one thinks that it's the same place just because of the name. So we do that even still today in our culture. And certainly the descendants of Noah would have remembered these different locations, different places, and then given them to new locations. Sometimes maybe in the near, like in a similar region, but not the same exact one. So, this is the Cush, the land of Cush that was then destroyed. The modern land of Cush is Ethiopia. And Gihon was destroyed. It no longer exists as it was then. Then, verse 14 gives these two rivers that are still even known today. And the name of the third river is the Tigris, or in Hebrew, Hiddekel. Tigris. And this is there in Mesopotamia, there like on the if you look at like biblical maps and stuff, you'll see most Bibles even have at the back. You'll see the river Tigris, you'll see Euphrates, and these are rivers that have that name even still today. But as I said, these rivers described here are not those same ones, because they can't be. Because there was a destruction that destroyed everything. So all that speculation that a lot of Bible commentators and a lot of Christians try and speculate and find the locations of these, it's kind of useless in the end, because just like the village, example of the houses in the village that had a certain name, it burned down. They were destroyed. Later they built new ones and called them the same. But then we get to verse 15. What does God do with the man he has created? We saw last week that God created, he formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living creature. Here in verse 15, we read, the Lord God took the man, which he has created, he took him and put him in the garden of Eden to work it and keep it. To work it and keep it. There's a lot packed in this little statement that might easily, we might not even comprehend and realize the significance of all of this. But simply said, we see here the calling that God has given to man and mankind in general, specifically here Adam, but to man, the calling that man have given, and we can see work as man's purpose. Work as man's purpose. God didn't create Adam just to sit around and like, oh, look at the beautiful garden I've made. Here's a nice chair. Sit here for the rest of your existence and just like, and like maybe sing spiritual songs for the rest of you. Just sit there. No, He put him in the garden to work it and to keep it. Even as Christians, we often think that, we might even say that, oh, you know, like work is a result of the curse. Like, oh, I'm looking forward to the day when there will be no work. You might even think that in the new heavens, new earth, there will be no more work. You would be wrong. You would be wrong, dead wrong. You might even think that there was no work before the fall, that it's just because we live in a cursed world when things are wrong, therefore we have to work. That's wrong. That's not true. Work is hard, and work is sometimes very boring and annoying and difficult in a sin-cursed world. Yes, but work itself does not have to be that, and work will not be, you know, annoying, boring, and greatly difficult in the future. Neither was it then. It is enjoyable. It is enjoyable. It's part of what God has made us to be. He created us to work. He created us to work. Even before the fall, even before sin, Adam was given a work assignment. In a perfect world, in a perfect garden, Adam had a job. He was called to be what I would call and define as, he was called to be a gardener guardian. Gardener guardian. Gardener guardian. That's what describes his work. What do I mean by gardener and a guardian? Well, the first aspect is the gardener, which is the easy one to understand. It says, God put him in the Garden of Eden to work it. It means to cultivate the land, to work the ground, and to do things. The garden would need someone to look over, take care of it. So even though it's perfect, even then, it was not some kind of plastic garden, you know, like you could get plastic plants. We have a plastic plant even here. You know, that plastic plant looks the same as it looked 10 years ago because it's plastic. It doesn't grow, it doesn't move. You know, it's nice, it gives some color to the room or whatever, but it's not at all as nice as a real plant. A real plant grows and it's beautiful and all that, but you also have to take care of a real plant. That's why we have a plastic one, because the real one would have probably died here. But God assigned Adam with the responsibility, the calling to work the garden. The original vocation given to man was to be a gardener, to watch over that which God has made. So that's kind of easy in some ways to understand. And obviously, because it's a garden, it's a specific designated area. Again, the importance of location. Like, it wasn't just everything. Adam knew, this is the garden, this is what I'm responsible of. It wasn't that Adam was just like one man in the whole earth and he was just like, he could never do it. No, he was given a reasonable task, a specific area, this specific area in the East of Eden, the garden, and that is what he was responsible over. And maybe the garden even was like, the borders of the garden maybe had like big trees to kind of clearly show where the garden ends and so forth. But this specific part was given to him, and he was to work it, and he was to keep it. What does it mean to keep it? What does it mean to keep it? If I give my son a little toy and I say, son, you know, keep it, keep it. Basically, he's to hold it, but part of that is he's to make sure that it's protected and that it's in good condition, and he will not break it or you know, throw it around or even let someone else have it. In that situation, if I say, keep it, you keep that. He's responsible to hold it, to protect it, to preserve it, to guard it. And Adam was given the responsibility right from the beginning to guard and to preserve and to protect this garden. Think about that. This is something that I've even just in recent months, this year, kind of for the first time really started to think, oh yeah, I never thought about that before, that Adam had been given not only just to garden, but to protect. So right from the beginning, man's purpose, Adam's purpose, is to cultivate, to serve the land, and to protect, to guard, to take care. And I think this is very important to understand as men, you know, and for women to understand what a man is called to do. At the very heart of what it means to be a man is the idea of protection, guarding and leading and protecting. Right from the beginning, he was given the charge to guard the garden. Later on, we know in Genesis chapter 3, we know that there's an intruder in the garden. Who's the intruder? Satan coming as a serpent to lie to his wife, who he was supposed to be, you know, taking care of also. And the wife is deceived. And then Adam goes along with it, sinning even more. And the whole thing is a mess. And that's why we live in a sin-cursed world. And we also have sinned just like Adam and Eve. We're followed in their sinful ways. Right from the beginning, God says, you better keep this. You work this and you keep it. You protect it. This word, keep, is the same word that is later in chapter 3, verse 24. So after Adam has sinned, Adam and Eve have sinned, and they've gone, God takes them out of the garden because of their sin and disobedience. Because Adam failed to keep the garden, because he failed to guard the garden, notice Genesis chapter 3, verse 34, God says, he drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim, so a spiritual being, like what we would think of like a you know, kind of angel being, but like even much, you know, terrifying angel, you know, holy angel, the cherubim and a flaming sword that turned every way to what? To guard the way to the tree of life. That's the same word, guard, to keep. Just like God then put this cherubim to guard that there's no one who is coming to the tree of life now. No one. He was guarding there. He was that Adam couldn't even go there. Adam was called to guard the garden. He was called to be on guard. He didn't know what to guard from. You know, there was nothing evil yet. There was nothing. But later the serpent would come and deceive. So we've seen the context. The context of all of this was the geography before the flood, these rivers. We've seen the calling, work as man's purpose. So the context and the calling, now we see the command. That's the last thing we'll look at here. The command, specifically the truth about that we are to trust the word of God. Because God speaks to Adam. He puts him there to work and keep it. And then in verse 16 he says, and the Lord God commanded the man. This is the first command in Scripture. This is even given before the dominion mandate. Like chronologically speaking, this is the first command that God gives to Adam. And he says, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden. So the command begins with a reminder that look at all these beautiful things that I've made. You can eat of every tree in the garden. All of this marvelous provision, greater than we can even imagine, is like, whoa. Adam should have been like, wow. But then verse 17. But there's one thing. There's one caveat. There's one negative comment. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. God gives one command. One command. One command. Why does he give this command? Why? Was it somehow that the tree itself was just somehow so, like, you know, that it was somehow, there was something magical powers in the tree, and God couldn't have created it any other way. So it's like, well, that tree somehow is there, and I just need to somehow, they can't touch it because otherwise things go bad, whatever. No, God is the one who created the tree. God is the one who put the tree there in the middle. So why did God put the tree in the middle? To test Adam's obedience, to test his submission, to test his trust in him as the creator. He is the creator who's created everything. Everything is more beautiful and glorious than we can even ever imagine. Everything is perfect. He is like, everything is just perfect. And one command, one little command, do not eat from that one tree. You have got all these other trees, all these fruits to enjoy. One tree, do not, do not. One tree. Adam was commanded to trust his creator. To trust his creator. Did God give a reason to why he was not to? Or like, did he say, well, he gives the negative reason saying, like, if you do it, you will surely die. But did he say, oh, the reason is that this tree contains something like this? Or, you know, like, did he somehow explain why he gave this command? No. Does God need to? No. No. Even as a father, I got four boys. And children from the beginning are very disobedient, as all of you know, even from your own childhood. I don't need to teach them to be rebellious. They just are because they're... But there's my sons, and I'm a sinful man, just like every other descendant of Adam and Eve. But sometimes I say, you know, Jeremiah, do this. And he says, why? I say, why? Why? And I say, because I told you to do this. That's all you need to know. That's all you need to know. Sometimes, of course, and I do, there's many times, and the older they grow, then we explain to them why different things. But in general, children should, and the better they understand that, the better children are. It's like, okay, I don't know why, but my father told me so, so I'm going to obey him. Because scripture tells me to honor my father, and he knows better, and he has authority. He has authority over me. So here, Adam is created by God, and God is the creator, the perfect one. And God says, do not do that. Do not do that. And God says to you, do not do that. Whatever it is now, command, whatever sin. Do you just go, well, you need to justify yourself. Come on, God. You're like, you need to explain to me in a way that makes sense to me, otherwise I won't do it. But that's how most people think. That's how even sometimes Christians think. It's enough that God says it. That's more than enough. And be careful against arguing against God, lest he crush you, lest he take your life. He's taken people's lives before for blasphemy and questioning his will. We should submit to him. We should submit to him. And there was one command. And I say, if you would have been in Adam's and Eve's shoes, then later I'm sure you would have sinned too. So just like... One command, this test of obedience, like Calvin calls it. It was a test of obedience. But notice also one other thing about this. Who does God give this command to? He gives it to Adam. Eve was not even yet created at this point. Eve is created here later. And we see from this, and this is completely politically incorrect, so to say, like this kind of view that I'm not just gonna, it goes against everything that our society obviously stands for. But the Bible teaches that men and women are equal, they're created in the image of God, they're equal in value and worth, but they are not the same in responsibility, and roles. Adam is given leadership. Men have been given by God leadership and responsibility. That's why as Christians, we believe that in the family, the man is the head of the household, the leader, the one who is in ultimate authority in the family. The man is under Christ and under Christ's leadership, but he's to lead and protect and guard his family. And we believe in the church, that in the church, which is the family of God, that men have been assigned, qualified men have been assigned with the leadership responsibility to lead the church, not women. That is not that women are less value. No, they have different roles. They have different roles. And when men do not take the role of leadership in their family or in other areas of life, when they do not do it rightly and God-honoringly, they are sinning against God. And when women seek to take leadership and seek to take roles that do not belong to them, they are rebelling against God. They are rebelling against God's created order. God's created order. Order. Adam was given this command, and then Eve is created later, and then Adam would have told it to his wife, of course. That's why Eve then knew it when the serpent came. And then, well, we'll get to that when we get to the fall into sin, but both Adam and both Eve, both of them sinned in different ways. And we have sinned, all of us, men and women, ever since. But leadership responsibility is given to the man. Well, the final thing here is that warning. What does God say? He says, "If but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall surely die." In the day that you eat of it you shall surely die. We know later they eat from it. We know later that Adam and Eve both die, but they did not die on that specific day. They lived about 900, Adam lived about 930 years. You know, people lived long way back then because of genetic mutations and problems in the human body were not that big. Or, you know, it gets worse and worse with every generation, even though we have medical technology, human beings get weaker and weaker because of mutations and corruption in the human body. But in the beginning, they were, of course, perfect, and then after the fall, everything started decaying. But Adam lived about 930 years after. So how should we understand this? God says, in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Well, the idea is here that you could almost say it, and I believe that's like the idea, or paraphrase it, is in the day that you eat of it, you will incur a death sentence. You will start dying. And what is death? Think about it. If we go, and there's a tree outside there, maybe now because all the leaves are gone, it's kind of hard to tell, but say, in the middle of summer, you know, a nice blooming apple tree, and you go with an axe or a saw and cut one branch off, and it's cut off now. And you look at the branch, it's like, it still looks the same. The leaves on this still look exactly the same as the rest of the tree. In fact, they still have even apples on it. But you've cut it. You've cut it from the life source. So it will take a little bit of time for the branch to, you know, start realizing in that sense that it no longer has water. It no longer has a water source. It's no longer connected to the life of the stem of the tree. And therefore, eventually, like the next day, in a few hours, the leaf will start shriveling, and eventually the whole thing will shrivel and such. That's just with a tree. But yet, the kind of the death, the beginning of that death of that branch is like when you cut it. So I think that's a helpful illustration of thinking. Adam and Eve, when they sinned against God, which we read in Genesis 3 then, in that day, in that moment, they're cut. their connection to spiritual life. They die spiritually, and their connection to God sustaining their physical life is cut off, and therefore they start decaying, and they are now under a death sentence from that day on, and they will die, and all their descendants will die eventually. That's why you and I will die, because our great-great-grandparents, Adam and Eve, sinned against God. God didn't create people to die in the beginning, but death came because of the fall, because of sin. And one day he will, of course, take away all death. And we will, as Christians, by trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, trusting in him who came and gave his life as a ransom for sinners like us, when we trust in him, we're forgiven of our sins. And we also await the future when he will raise us up. He will raise our bodies, give us new bodies. He will restore all things. And we will be with him on the new heavens and the new earth, which we often say heaven. We will be with him in heaven. And there will be no death. There will be no suffering. There will be no crying, no tears. But this command, this original command, is to teach that mankind is to always trust the Creator. Mankind was not created to be an autonomous being. Autonomous meaning that you just make decisions apart from God. You submit to God. You submit to God. And today we have, you know, the Word of God in Scripture. The whole Bible is the Word of God. And that's why as Christians we submit to that. And there's times when we don't even understand something. Just like my son, when I tell him to do this, and I don't tell him why he should do it, I just tell him to do it. We should do it because God tells us to do it, whether he explains it to us or not. So, we look forward to that day. And when you watch whatever, or if you watch something or read some books about fictional worlds and stuff, just remember, reality is even greater. Reality is even better. And the earth in the past was destroyed, but the earth in the future will be restored. And all those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ will be with him on the new heavens and the new earth and enjoy eternal life with him. So let me pray. Our Father, we thank you that you are God. We thank you that you are a gracious God. All of us deserve eternal judgment. All of us deserve eternal hell. All of us deserve eternal death because of our sin, because of all our disobedience against you. Adam and Eve broke in one command. We've broken so many, more than we even realize, more than we even remember. Lord, we thank you that you have not left us in the judgment that we deserve, but you provided a Savior in the Lord Jesus Christ who came 2,000 years ago. He lived a perfect life, a perfect life. Adam failed. Adam sinned against you, but the second Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ, he did not fail. He has never failed and will never fail. And he lived a perfect life and died for sinners on the cross like us. And he rose from the dead, defeating death itself. And one day he will come again. Lord, may we trust him all the more. And if there's anyone who is here or who listens even to this message that doesn't trust you, Lord, I pray that they might submit to you. They might realize, like just like Adam was called to trust you as their creator, they are called to submit to you and to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ who died for sinners, and that you would save them. You would open their hearts to receive the truth. Lord, help us to be a witness to people around us, in our families, in our neighborhoods, and in our workplace or studies, wherever, to be a blessing to other people, and that we might tell others of the great news that we have heard, the great news of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, who has saved us from the sin that we deserve, from the judgment that we deserve. So Lord, we thank you for this time, and we ask your blessing on the rest of our day and our time together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.